because she was a defensive liability. She has worked her way into being a game-saving player back there. What a compliment to this young lady.
Fitzmaurice and Stanford to start things off here in the fourth set, and quickly a perfect kill out of the middle off the good pass from Paige Tapp. What do you expect from Stanford, Cards? We looked at their offensive numbers in the third. Stanford hit only 049. Minnesota not great at 205, and still the set was fairly close.
Right now, Minnesota looks a lot more energized than Stanford. We saw Lutz hit a number of swings out of bounds where she could have put the ball to the floor. They look like they were really hungry to get it in free, but Minnesota's not going to go down without a fight, so Stanford has to figure out a way to put themselves right back in a position to close it out in four here.
I know it's only the fourth set, but I thought Stanford got a little tired. There are a lot of very, very long rallies where Lutz and Plummer, among others, are having to take multiple swings. Plummer, first look here in the fourth. Nice dig down the line by Seliger Swenson. Oh, that deflection. Rosado was there, but Alexis Hart does not have eyes in the back of her head and took that one away from her teammate. Stanford won the opening set 26-24. They won the second easily 25-19. And then Minnesota, in a must-win situation, took the third 25-22. Averages just about two kills per set, but a very efficient attacker, number 13 in white.
And she's got eight kills out of 17 swings without an error. If I were Minnesota, I'd absolutely look to get the ball to her more. Interesting how these teams are so good defensively that they're both holding their respective offenses far, far below their season averages.
We looked at the numbers, we looked at your serving chart, Karch, and I just get the impression that Minnesota, outserved, outpassed in the first two sets, has really gone back to their strength in the third and the start here in the fourth. They are really good here in the serve-receive phase.
Even with a couple of uncharacteristic service errors on their behalf in the third set.
Because they never serve out. Down the line, this time by twin sister Hannah Tapp.
Remember, in the second set, Vanya was blocking swings like that, setting up in good spots. Now, Minnesota getting that swing off the one-footed jump, the slide attack around successfully, navigating around that block.
Tight pass. Well, that's down the line. What a dig by Rosado. Double contact is called, and no complaint about that. But talk about standing your ground by Rosado, wearing number 17 in the Libero's black jersey.
Great. Most of good defense is just getting hit by the ball, even if it means taking it in a shoulder or a stomach. Remember at the start of this match, though, we talked about how we thought that we were going to let it play on a couple of those early suspect contacts. She's been calling it a little tighter since then. Lutz.
That is a late cover by Moretta Lutz. That ball's got to come up. That was not a bad swing at all by Vanya high up into the Minnesota block. That should have reached and set the point.
Yeah, but if you're 6'8 and you're standing tall, your knees are straight, you're never going to have enough time to make that play. So she's got to get low and expect the ball to come back off that block.
There's defensive specialist Gaynor. Percentage, but Fitzmaurice and Ijonicu, not many opportunities in that third.
And some of the ones Ijonicu did have were set too low. She had a couple of chances if she had been set at the right height to help Stanford stay closer in that third set.
Look at Minnesota, right on target, right in system again, dug by Plummer. And Fitzmaurice, two blockers up out of the middle. Beautifully done by Wilhite, helping out second-team All-American Hannah Tapp.
Yes, number 8, Sarah Wilhite. See how she shoved way into her right side so that she could become a very strong helping blocker for Minnesota. Minnesota, causing stuff a lot.
Nobody there to swing. Vanyak had to go down and cover that off-speed shot. So far for Ivana Vanyak. Six kills, 23 swings. Doesn't hit for a very high percentage, but doing her job. That ball hit out of bounds, but a touch was detected off the Stanford block, and no complaints there. So registering another kill, Sarah Wilhite now 22 kills on 62 swings. It's okay, the winner gets a day off tomorrow.
Unlike last week.
Wow, exactly right, Cart. You took the words right out of my mouth.
What a save by Gray.
Off the top of the block, and a fortunate play that time for Stanford as Catherine Plummer used all 6'6" to register the 15th block for Stanford against 10 for Minnesota.
Stanford's doing is they're hitting some soft shots behind the block, and that's forcing somebody like Sarah Wilhite way across the court so that even if Minnesota gets it up, they can't get a swing out of it.
Good set in transition. Rosado can't dig that one out with the left hand. Beautiful play out of the backcourt. Kelsey Humphrey dishing that ball up to Plummer. Look at Plummer's numbers now, 13 kills on 37 swings. 6 lead now for the Cardinal. Ijonicu talking to Plummer. There with Gray as well. Ijonicu in the middle up front. Good play on the quick this time, once again by Minnesota. They're passing much better. Their offense is clicking right now.
It sure is. And the setter, Seliger Swenson, made a really nice choice because Inki Ijonicu, no taps, just kills, made a nice adjustment because Inki Ijonicu was shading toward the other half.
Don't say no taps. I get the idea, but those two sisters have been awfully good for Minnesota for 4 years. That ball is going to be missed out of bounds. Hart just looking for the deep cross-court corner. Remember, coming up, Texas and Nebraska. Nebraska, the number one overall seed. Texas, the number four seed. Both of them were on life support last weekend. Nebraska at home against Penn State. Texas coming back from a 12-7 deficit in the fifth to eliminate BYU. Good cover by Marta. Ijonicu was... Oh, Inki Ijonicu! Straight down stuff against Wilhite, one-on-one.
What's called the machine team is cheering her on from the sideline. The B team for Stanford taking such pride in pushing the A team every day in practice. They've got a dance and a move for every great thing that Stanford's A team executes.
I wonder where they learned that, Kurt. Where did they learn that? Your team kind of became famous for that.
Well, and of course, they have one of our team members now as coach, Cassidy Lickman, sitting on the sidelines. And so she was a part of a whole USA effort to try to add energy and help people be ready for when they came into the game.
That one-on-one block. Tight pass. Finish that thought in a moment. Was the ninth for Ijonicu. Oh, nice play by Moretta Lutz into the cross court. Remember when we talked to Inki Ijonicu yesterday? She missed all of last year after tearing her ACL at the beginning of the season, even though all of the strength and conditioning coaches and her physical therapist says your knee is sound, but she was nowhere near 100%. Inki Ijonicu is as close to 100% right now as she's been since before she hurt her knee.
She's faced a couple of challenges. Number one, trying to get rid of the doubt about her own ability to come back, and then also...
McCutcheon is challenging here. Hugh McCutcheon is contending that Stanford committed a net violation during the rally, so he will have to tell the officials exactly when in that point it occurred, and it'll be up to the technicians to dial back to that. Again, three challenges per match. Coach McCutcheon and his staff challenging that number one for the Cardinal, Jenna Gray, during the course of that rally, brushed the net. This is a tough one because you got to find exactly the right play. This is the play in question.
And if it's her hair, which is a possibility in that angle, then that is a legal, a permissible play. But if it's another part of her body, it is not legal.
Well, based on that, that's inconclusive because the video evidence has to be 100% conclusive to overturn the call on the floor.
I think they're going to have to look at the along the net view also. There's the hair, and of course you can't really see anything as Plummer runs across the screen on that play.
No net violation. So each team has used one challenge. They have two remaining here in the fourth set with Stanford leading 2-1. They both have their two timeouts remaining. Plummer will continue to serve. Stanford on top, 11-8. Good kill coming out of that one. Essentially, it was a timeout for the challenge. Another kill by all Big Ten first-team performer, Hannah Tapp. We're told Minnesota has used two challenges, so Hugh McCutcheon has only one remaining.
Yeah, they tried to challenge that touch call in the previous game.
Yep, good call,
and
Karch.
We had a great replay. That right thumb getting touched.
Thank you, Ajanoku, ripping right over the top of the block. Get you back to Ajanoku's numbers. 13 kills on 27 swings. Four errors coming off a great performance last week when she had 20 kills on 38 attempts. But now she goes to the sideline. What will Stanford do with their three-time All-American out of the match? Morgan Hintz will give them an opportunity. Vanya over the top of the block.
That's one of the adjustments I'm seeing Stanford make, is that when they don't have the swing, Vanyak or Plummer on the left, they're tipping the ball right over the block of Minnesota. It's giving them fits.
Timeout called by Minnesota. After winning the second set 25-22, the Golden Gophers in trouble once again against the young Stanford Cardinal, trailing 13-9. Sunderland, Morgan Hintz back to serve. Stanford 7-3 run. Good adjustment by Minnesota, not having hard cut of the tip. Two women blocked. Vanyak and Fitzmaurice stuffing Wilhite out of the pipe.
But exactly right, Paul. Minnesota doing some adjustments. Look at that, help by Vanyak and making Fitzmaurice's job easier. Minnesota changing up its defense a little so they can free their left side hitters to be more a part of the offense when that tip over the end blocker comes up.
Could Minnesota's high-speed offense, the fastest in the country, deal with the length of Stanford? So far, not. Stanford leads 2-1 and has 17 scoring blocks, a huge number. Stanford leads it by 4. Wilhite, off-speed shot, getting a little bit lucky off the inside hand of the Stanford block. Remember, Stanford still has both of its timeouts.
Standing straight up, she's staying low and ready to lay it out, keeping that, stealing a certain point away from Minnesota. You've got to love plays like that because it's so frustrating for the other team. They did everything right to score and don't come up with a point.
On the second contact, Jenna Gray. Locking balls, digging balls, setting a good offense, and now here registering a kill. Biggest lead of the fourth set for Stanford, 16-11. Served out of bounds. Remember that miss. Stanford now with six service errors to only two for Dalian Lee's Rosado in Minnesota.
And Stanford's had a little trouble in this rotation. India Jonathan is still a couple of rotations away from being able to check back into the game.
So it's up to the Indians. And two in a row.
That's really the libero from Minnesota, Dalian Lee's Rosado. That is her responsibility. She's got to be a captain in the backcourt. And she, if she's not going to get that, she has to warn her wing defenders to help out with that.
Jenna Gray chipping in with five kills out of the setting position. Will Height coming right through off the block and out of bounds. Will Height, as you might imagine, for potentially the National Player of the Year, the Big Ten Player of the Year. 24 kills on 68 swings after a pretty slow start. Here's Seliger Swenson. That ball into the antenna and missed that time by Fitzmaurice. Minnesota, there's no way they're going away. They have played five sets time and time and time again. Competition in the Big Ten and the Pac-12, for that matter, has prepared these teams for these kind of moments.
Including four matches in about 8 days to finish up the Big Ten, all of which went five, all of which they won.
Stanford needs this. I know they have a lead, but they need this. Power high up off the block and out of bounds. A little extra effort into that kill.
Coach Dunning gives her, Plummer that is, a ton of credit. He said she just doesn't ever get nervous or distracted. She's constantly poised out there far beyond her years.
Well, first team All-American as a freshman, the National Freshman of the Year. Quickly to Wilhite, and another kill. Minnesota has to be almost perfect in serve receive for the rest of this set to stay alive. Inkia Jonicu back in up front. Stanford's got to pass well so they can get a Jonicu the ball. Plummer missed it out of bounds. 18-16. Again, Minnesota facing a must-win situation, trailing two sets to one. Timeout called by Stanford. Each team with one timeout remaining. Minnesota has one challenge left, and by my count, Stanford has two. Teams to the sideline, so we want to remind you, NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship coverage continues with the National Championship Saturday, December 17th at 9 p.m. Eastern over on ESPN2. For more information on the NCAA Women's Volleyball Championship, visit NCAA.com, your home for all 90 NCAA championships. Take us inside the Stanford huddle here, Karch. Obviously pass first, so Inky's involved.
And the coaches give them some time, so clearly Inky is leading that huddle as a player before the coaches join. Coach Dunning now calming them down. Remember, in the third set, they made some unforced hitting errors, and now we've seen it again, hitting into the antenna and then hitting out of bounds, Plummer did. But when they can get the pass they want, they can get the ball to a Jonicu on offense. They did not have that kind of pass that very last play. That's the way they want to get the ball to a Jonicu.
A Jonicu now with 13 kills. And for more, let's go back over to Holly.
In that last huddle for Stanford, Inkia Jonicu trying to get her teammates to just focus on each other. She said, I want us looking at each other. We only need to worry about what's happening on our side of the court. If we take care of our side of the court, all of our cares will be gone. They want more focus, more determination. And actually, John Dunning came in right at the end there, and he said, we need to be a little bit smarter what they're hitting in. Pointing out Catherine Plummer on that last bad swing.
Thank you, Holly. Minnesota on a 4-1 run. Will Height has not been great out of the back row so far, but she can certainly be a weapon on the pipe.
Two blockers looking for a Jonaku, and they get the touch they want. Minnesota does.
Big swing for Plummer into the cross court, dumped by Rosada. Morgan hits again. Hart just keeping this ball in play.
Oh, another cover by Hintz.
And this time stuffed, and Minnesota is within one. A couple of marvelous plays. World-class plays by Morgan Hintz. Minnesota has really started to turn up the blocking set by set. It had been all Stanford in that category, but they had four in the third and now three in the fourth. And Jonaku off the top. Great stretch out with a left hand to Luigi for Will Height, and a much-needed side-out score for a Jonaku in Stanford.
And that set is still too low for Inkia Jonaku. She is not able to hit it with her elbow at about full extension.
Well, Jenna Gray has been spectacular, but she's got to become really precise with a Jonaku to get this one across the finish line. What a block by Plummer. One on one. Huge play to give Stanford a little bit of separation at 20-17, and a timeout called by Minnesota. Wow, it has been the blocking early, and now a critical stuff late here, Karch, for Catherine Plummer, the 18th for Stanford.
And that fatigue is what leads to some of those hitting errors. Lets us hit out a few times. Plummer, we saw hit out down the line. That was where Coach Dunning said, let's take smarter swings, aim for the court.
Here is Gray. Both teams hitting well below their season averages, but you'd expect it at this level. Rising and hammering over the top of the block. Beautiful swing for number 19.
Boy, is she elevating. She has Inky Jonaku somewhat late. Still have a little dig like to hit at through between the two-person block. Another low set. Gotta make a Jonaku reach more to have success against three blockers. You can see all the Minnesota blocking attention on a Jonaku.
How are you setting a Jonaku this low, this late in the season? They've been working together since August. Bit of confusion there. Tap might have had a chance to get after that. As Jonaku said, remember Hugh McCutcheon said she'll get the attention she deserves.
2 points ago, three players, six hands in front of her. And that's when, if you can recognize that Paul is a setter, you can set somewhere else and get a one-on-zero hitting opportunity.
Will Height out of the pipe, going off speed. Vanyak, no, right side deluxe is stuffed by Lohman, number 13 in white. Clutch block by Molly Lohman. Minnesota back within one.
Out of bounds,
so back-to-back points. Good news for Stanford. They get the kill from Ejonikou. They get that miss there, but Nikki Ejonikou on the sideline, 23-21. Stanford 2 points away. Minnesota, not yet. Good kill down the line.
Absolutely, Hannah Tapp threading the needle. Bonham didn't leave her much line, but Ejonikou not on the court to help carry the offensive load for Stanford.
And where do the Cardinal go for a side out here? First contact, anything goes. Crossbody is done. Back to Fitzmaurice, on the wrist away. Minnesota will, oh, a tough, tough chance. Minnesota absolutely laying it out. That was Alyssa Gaynor going after that ball. And now it's going to be two match points for the Stanford Cardinal. Match point number one. Shank pass, that's still good. Stanford's moving on. Semifinals will now set a record once again. The Cardinals' 20th appearance in the national semifinals, and with this 3-1 win over Minnesota, will be making their 15th appearance for the national championship against either Texas or Nebraska.